It was an incredibly hot summer's day in sunny Bath.
He was with a guy I knew called Paul, and I thought that he was a French exchange student, which are those foreigners that come over once a year and you go over there, sort of thing.
His name was Kurt. Short guy. Very Indian looking. Dark hair and a tan. He wasn't allowed out that day because he'd previously been in a fight.
He thought that I was Indian, apparently, which is probably something to do with the turban I was wearing at the time. Three things I remember about the shoot. Everybody wants to rule the world. A whole bunch of things. One was having to get up at 4:30 in the morning to catch the sunrise scene next to a salt lake that stank. Two was having to share a bed with Steve, our sound guy, in a camper in the middle of nowhere. And three was taking the Austin Healey car for a spin, literally.
I was looking for someone to work with, and I had a small 8-track studio, and I'd heard that they were the only people around with any strong musical ideas.
Kurt and I were in a vegetarian discotheque late one night in Bath, bopping away, and this tall geezer came up to us, bent over, and said, "Would you like to use my 8-track recording studio for free?" Well, I thought that was a bit steep, so we knocked him down a bit, agreed to pay him. Glenine Palace. And this is the set we're going to be playing on in a minute. Set up for us already in front of the main entrance. This is for some Japanese television program we're doing. It's going to be live broadcast over thousands of miles to Japan.
This is what's known as a dodgy hired drum kit. Where's my drum, Batman?
Okay, for the one shot. Please, okay. Let's go. Sound.
Bit nippoy.
Are you originally from London?
No, we're from a city called Bath in the West Country.
Mm.
It's quite hot.
Small?
Yeah, it's quite a hot American tourist spot, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And we've been over here for about a week and a half, just looking around stuff. We just happened to pop in here.
Yeah.
So.
Well, most stately homes around the country actually have pop rooms.
After 1 minute, please.
1 minute, everybody. Right, thank you. Did you get that, Graham? Yes. From now on, I won't ask you to acknowledge
the
suit. Okay. Here we go.
ほら、紹介しなきゃ。
今、ティアーズ・フォー・フィールドの皆さん来ていますけれども、紹介しましょう。
はい、お願いします。
はい、OK。Could you self introduce
to the
Japanese audience, please?
Yes, my name's Ian.
Ian.
Pa.
Roland.
Roland. Roland.
Kurt.
Kurt.
And Manny.
Manny というそうです。
Apparently Winston Churchill used to live here, I believe.
Chris Cooper, I lost the
Kebab, please, pan.
Would you like Japanese food?
Graham, another group, another one. Graham, another one.
Yeah. Hi, we hear you come to Japan to have concert, but when it will be?
I believe it's the last 2 weeks in July. The program's sponsored by Honda. And, Suzuki are using Shout for their for a TV ad, and Honda wanted us to do a different song.
Are you guys all right? Ready to do it? Yeah.
Thomas, go ahead.
Okay. それでは、イギリスより、Tears for Fears のシャウトを送りいたします。Let's go.
Quarter inch, okay?
Go.
Ricky Studio. 5-on-1. I mean 1-on-5.
What
the fuck is that doing?
Right.Shout, shout, shout,
these are the things I can do without. Come on, I'm talking to you. Come on.
Okay, count to three.
Shout, shout, let it all out. These are the things I can do without. Come on.
This sort of stuff. $60,000. Raw fish. One speaker.
Coming to you, Graham, in a minute.
Shout, shout, let it all out.
いない方がいい。
Powers that be kindly granted me a month off to finish writing songs for the album, Songs from the Big Chair. I came up with, well, actually I stole a rhythm from a Talking Heads track, and I had had a bass synth sound, an ominous bass synth sound, and I was just playing around with it and dancing about, jigging about, and suddenly it hit me from the outer cosmos, all at once, shout. Simply, it's about protest, it's about making a noise about things either politically or socially that disturb you. For instance, nuclear weapons or whatever. When I wrote it, I found it quite therapeutic just to sing these words, these are the things I can do without. And I think that's has been part of its appeal to a lot of people. Initially it was just a chorus, and the idea I had at the time was that it would be a kind of mantra thing and it would be repeated over and over again.
I went round to his house one day and he was working in his dining room downstairs and he just played it, and I don't know, it took weeks to convince him that it was any good, but there was something about the way he sang it that, you know, you can tell when he's giving something.
Ian came down, Ian Stanley came down, and I played it to him and he said, that's a worldwide smash. I said, you've got to be joking.
It was the first record, the first single that we'd release, which I'm totally happy with. There's nothing that I'd change on it. I think it's the best version of the song we could have done.
Let it all.
Listen came about during the time of the hurting. Roland and Kurt were up in London doing interviews, I think, for a few days. So I had some time spare. And I was just working at home one night. I just started messing around with a few synths and drum machines and stuff. And did it all in a couple of days, played everything on it. This is the demo. And then when we decided to do it for the album, I was very nervous about it because it was sort of my baby, really. It was, you know, no one else had much to do with it. And it was very incongruous to everything else that we were doing.
Thank you. But did you play rugby at school?
Yeah.
Did you? Mm. But you didn't enjoy it?
I enjoyed it up until the point I got knocked out. And then I couldn't tackle anybody anymore, and that was it for me. I was had to resign myself to timpani lessons.
Seriously?
I was excused games for timpani lessons.
I had what you could call a very unorthodox background. Neither of my parents had normal jobs, 9-to-5 jobs. My father had a nervous breakdown when I was 3 years old and became semi-bedridden. And to make money, he decided to run an entertainment agency with my mother, who was a dancer. Now, we had an awful lot of different entertainers around the house. We had conjurers, escape artists, cat jugglers, and quite a lot of guitarists and singers. And that's where I first got into the guitar as a means of accompanying the voice.
Tori.
Used to wear a little red t-shirt, and she's about this high.
I mean, we were about 14
I've seen all three
young
of her on stage.
Boy's dream.
Bart in a bath.
Legs straight. No bending knees.
Can't I just say alles gut, ja? Say again.
Guten Abend. Alles gut, ja? This is our first concert in Germany.
It's weird because to us we'd had success before because we were very successful in England, and when it's your home country you don't really consider everywhere else in the world. I find it now very strange that we're going to countries that I've never been to before, and our records have been like number one, but I've never been there. The idea from the title was from a film called Sybil, which is about a girl with 14 different personalities, and her analyst has this very large chair that when she regresses back to certain personalities in her past, she always wants to sit with her analyst in this big chair because it's the place where she feels comfortable, not scared of anyone, not frightened about what the outside world thinks of her. And it conjured up just a really nice image for us, so we decided to use it for the B-side of Shout. And when we got to the album title, we had a lot of choices. And in the end, because the album is very much a combination of eight songs, we decided to call it Songs from the Big Chair.
You're absolutely fantastic. No, I actually mean that. My kind of town. Stuttgart.
Well, I think the hurting period was influenced by all my childhood more than anything else. I think that the album was an album that we wanted to do for quite a few years, which was based around our childhood experiences and our current thoughts about them, I think.
Thoughts. Get in line with the things you know. Feel the pain, feel the sorrow. Touch the hurt and don't let go. Don't let go, don't let go. Get in line with the things you know. Learn to cry like a baby. Then the hurting won't come back. Won't come back, won't come back. Yes, 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 yes.
After the hearsing, we got very much involved in our own home studio. We learnt all about reverb and EQ and all the things that kind of come in handy when you're in a recording studio. So much so that we sort of forgot about the song, and we actually attempted making records without songs and then fitting songs in later to a bunch of interesting sounds. That resulted in the single called The Way You Are, which, if you analyse it, has some great bits in, but together is pretty hard to get a hold of. It took us quite a long time to break out of that, and eventually we did, with a more raucous version of Mother's Talk. Mother's Talk is basically two ideas. The first comes from an old wives' tale, which mothers say to their children. When their children pull a face, they say, "You'll stay like that when the wind changes." And so that's where I got the idea for the lyric, "My features form with a change in the weather."
My features form with a change in the weather.
Also, around about the time I was finishing the lyric, the American nuclear missiles were being brought into England, and a lot of people were quite scared about it. I certainly was. And therefore it took on a nuclear flavour, which is not, I don't think, out of keeping with the initial idea. Starts to burn, then you'll know that you're in trouble. Also, there's a cartoon book by a guy called Raymond Briggs, which is called When the Wind Blows, which again is about a potential Third World War. And that's where I got the line, When the Wind Blows.
Some of us are horrified, others never talk about it. But when the weather starts to burn, then you'll know that you're in trouble. Follow in the footsteps of a soldier girl. It is time to put your clothes on and to face the world. Don't you feel your luck is changing when everything starts to
was not conceived as a touring band. It was first a studio setup. Was it more out of necessity that you turned into a touring band?
Yeah, the reason we were a recording band was because we'd been in a live band before, myself and Roland, and slogged our way around the clubs and got nowhere. Because when we used to make records, we used to go in the studio and record as a live band, and it just didn't work on the record. It just doesn't work that way. You have to know how to record. So when we split from that group, we decided we'd learn how to record, because it is a necessity. If you want to get anywhere, you've got to make good records. And so we went into a studio, into an 8-track with Ian Stanley, and learned how to layer our songs and how to use a studio and to use different keyboards. And so initially, we were very much shied away from playing live, because it really ruined us before.
I believe that when the hurting I'm crying while I write these words. Is it dead?
The working hour came about when we were rehearsing for our second or third tour at a school called King Edward's School in Bath. And I was just messing about on the drums and came up with the basic pattern that goes on during the verse of the song, which Roland latched onto. And he started playing some chords to them. Ian had another set of chords, which were a totally different song. We just put the two together, and it seemed to work.
This is Munich in the summer. This is Tears for Fears. I'm Paul Version number one. This is The Working Hour.
Largest entertainment magazine of Europe.
And who are you photographing today?
The band called Tears for Fears. Tears for Fears, is that right?
No.
What was your name?
We're called The Beatles.
The Beatles!
That's great.
Oh.
I've now taken up photography. So instead of strumming a guitar, I stroke my camera collection. It's just nice to have something that's not put on display, not put in public, something that you're not criticised for, basically.
Photography was, I don't know, something that appealed to us, I think. And it's coming useful. I mean, we take pictures for the inner bags of albums and things, and for our own fan club posters and stuff.
I mean, it's more, I mean, I don't consider myself, you know, very good or anything. It's more the actual enjoyment of doing it. And I'd hate to be yet another musician who publishes a book of photographs that's not any good.
Click.
Tears for Fears. Everybody wants to rule the world.
Welcome to
There's been two distinct stages in Tears for Fears history so far. Both albums, The Hurting, in which you could say we laid ourselves bare. We made a very fragile album, which was full of adolescent kind of emotions that most people try to forget and sweep under the carpet. With songs from The Big Chair, in the song Mother's Talk, it was time to put our clothes on and to face the world.
Tomorrow, we're playing our 100th gig on this world tour here in sunny Seattle. And we finished the tour the end of November, which is probably before this actually goes out. But that's in about 3 months, 2.5 months' time. And then we're going to take a long holiday and start writing for the new album.
Maybe we'll lay ourselves bare again, wide open, but maybe this time revealing an incredibly hairy chest.
Das ist meine Lieblingsgruppe Tears for Fears with Shout!
we are in Germany, and we're what you call gigging. Gigging is a word used in the rock business for when you do a show. We've been gigging tonight. Hope you've enjoyed it.